We are in our fourth week of our series on the family, which brings us to the topic of singleness. Now, some of you are thinking, okay, I've been married a long time. I'm a grizzled veteran when it comes to marriage. I don't need to hear about singles. Well, you know a single. You once were single. You will be a parent of a single at some point. And so we, in fact, do need to know about singleness. And the scriptures actually have a lot to say about it. So that's what we're going to look at this morning. And it's easy to sort of diminish. It's easy to look past, as a church, those who are single, or maybe those who are young. And it's honestly sometimes easy to have a little fun at their expense, which we're going to do right now. And so I got a video late one evening this week, about 11 o'clock, and nearly fell out of bed. Vicky's like, what's so funny? And so there's a generation called millennials. I'm a father of three of them, so I get it. They're young, maybe a little restless, and here's a little something about them.
Ding, ticka, ding, ticka, ding, 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 ding. There he sits inside your local coffee shop, sporting a mane, bun, and facial hair. Somehow he believes, although he has no job, that by his 30s he will be a millionaire. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. Instagram with the quote that's inspirational, hopes to change the world while wearing yoga pants, armed with her dreams and knowledge of essential oils. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A. Criticism isn't easy for their ears. They feel like they know most everything. See, they grew up with undeserved confidence, 'cause they got trophies just for participating. M-I-L-L-E-N-N-I-A.
Fun. It's easy to laugh at the next generation. That's only been happening forever. But I am very, very optimistic about the next generation. Those millennials are very idealistic, in the best sense of the word, of idealistic. They are less about chasing a dollar and more about making a difference in the world. And that is fully in alignment with what God is intended on doing. And so the scriptures are bullish on the young. The scriptures are bullish on singleness. So I want to take some time this morning to develop a biblical understanding. Maybe we would call it a practical theology of singleness. And then we want to spend some time developing that into what does that mean day to day for those who are single. They find themselves in that situation. How should I live then in that way? And so 1 Corinthians chapter 7 is where we'll be. Go ahead and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Let me help us by recognizing that it is difficult to live today in this world as a follower of Jesus Christ. And it is more than that, perhaps, difficult for someone who is a single person living for Jesus Christ. Blogger Bethany Horvath a year ago wrote this: "It's hard to live a single life consistent with the standard God has placed on His children." That's true. They live in a day, as we do, of bewildering change. They live in a day where there's a blizzard of media messages, often contrary to biblical understanding of how I should use my singleness for God's glory and the good of His kingdom. So we want to begin, when we talk about singleness, by asking this question: for what purpose am I single? Getting a good handle on that will help us get a long way towards understanding what it is I ought to be doing in this season of my life. Single person, understand, you are not in between things. You are not on the shelf or on the sideline waiting for God to actually do something in your life. Thoughtful believers, followers of Jesus Christ, those who are single, are always asking the question, for what purpose? During this time of my life, am I single? What is it God's going to do in my life or through me in the life of the church or my community that otherwise would not be possible? Because for now, I am a single. There have been maybe competing views on singleness over the years. Certainly the traditional understanding, and I grew up with this in small town northern Indiana, was that, Scott, when you grow up, get married, have children, and you'll amount to something. Almost as though marriage was some kind of an idol out here that we idolize, and if you do those things, then good. And the churches can overtly or maybe subconsciously deliver that message a little bit with constant focus on marriage improvement or constant focus on a marriage building, and those are important things, but we need to recognize in our congregation, 30 to 40% of our members are single. There's a, maybe it's more modern, maybe it's the last 15, 20 years or so, sort of a competing vision of singleness, not well, the goal is get married. The idol on the pedestal is marriage and children and job and home, and maybe a more modern turn of phrase, maybe a more modern idol on the shelf is don't get married too soon. You pursue a college and career and let's make some money and maybe have some fun. So that in that case, don't marry too soon. Don't stay in a troubled marriage or hurt for a broken marriage. The idol is fulfillment. One pastor I listened to this week put it this way: the modern world, marriage is viewed as an asset in my portfolio. Ultimately, it's about me, and it should enhance me. The biblical view of marriage and singleness is much, as you would expect from the scriptures, more balanced and in alignment with the reality of the world and how we were created. So, 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Here's the, if you want to use the word thesis statement, here's the theme, not only 1 Corinthians chapter 7, especially the where we're going to cover from verses 17 forward, but the theme of my message this morning: singleness is an honorable way to please the Lord. Here's what believers get. If you're single, you're living this, or that's the goal toward which you ought to be driving. If we're married, this is the way we should pray for our singles. This is the way we should communicate to our children that singleness is an honorable way to please the Lord. So, question then, if singleness is an honorable way to please the Lord, how can I please the Lord as a single? 1 Corinthians chapter 7, we're going to pick it up beginning in verse 17. Now, when you come to a text of Scripture and you go to the middle of a chapter, it's like walking into a movie halfway through. So you need a little context. 1 Corinthians chapter 7 is all about relationships, the most intimate family-style relationships we have. A marriage, what would be the biblical equivalent of dating, that is engagement and things like that. A divorce, widows and widowers. Sexuality, I mean, it's very practical and very intimate kind of stuff. We get to chapter 7, verse 17, and I'm going to read you the bookend, verse 17 and verse 24 of this paragraph, and I'll explain why here in a moment, but here's what Paul says. Listen, single person, Let each person lead the life that the Lord has assigned to him and to which God has called him. Here's the first principle. How can I live a life that honors the Lord Jesus Christ as a single? Be at peace. What's going to make you happy and complete is not out there somewhere. It's not in someone else. In fact, look at verse 24. Verse 17 says, lead the life the Lord has assigned to you. Verse 24 says, so brothers, in whatever condition each was called, let him there remain with God. What he means by that, and here he references those who are slaves, that's a horrible thing, but in those days, indentured service, whether it be for debt or maybe you sold yourself into slavery for the security of having a job, or he talks about those who have ethnicity, you're Jewish and the marks of your Judaism you shouldn't remove. Here's what he's saying. When God called you into his family by faith, when you responded to the gospel message, whatever condition you found yourself in, you are capable of pleasing God in that place. If you were, let's bring the analogy to what we're dealing with this morning, singleness, because that's where he's going to go in the next section. If you were single when God saved you, you can live fully for God as a single. If you were married when God saved you, you can live fully for God as a married person, even if you're married to an unbeliever. We don't have to look outside of ourselves. We don't have to wonder, well, if only my circumstances would change, God would be pleased with me. Verse 24, whatever condition he was called, let him remain, listen, what's that last phrase? With God. There's that sense of God's presence in our situation. So, be at peace. Understand that where God has us, he's doing something in our lives. In fact, I like where verse 29 begins. He says, this is what I mean. In other words, let me explain to you. Because for some of you may say, you know, really honestly, Scott, I'm not sure that's the case. I really want to get married. And so this is what I mean, brothers, verse 29. The appointed time has grown very short. From now on, and listen about all the relationships that he talks about. He talks about marriage. He talks about merchants. He talks about buyers and sellers. He talks about all of these different really important relationships we find ourselves in. From now on, the end of verse 29, let those who have wives live as though they had none. It doesn't mean ignore your spouse. It means aim for something greater than just ultimate satisfaction in my spouse. And those who mourn as though they're not mourning. It doesn't mean we're going to diminish suffering or hurt or loss or grief. It means beyond the grief, beyond the mourning, there's something better to look forward to. Those who rejoice as though we're not rejoicing, laughing or enjoying life, that's not the ultimate goal, as great as those things are. Those who buy as though they had no goods. Don't be owned. Don't be a materialist. Don't be owned by what you own. Those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with the world. Here it is, right? For the present form of this world is passing away. Single person. There is a future relationship that will far surpass any fulfillment or any idealized idea you have today of what it's going to be like. Jesus has promised that at the return or upon our death, at the return of Christ or upon our death, there will be a union, there will be a consummation, there will be a relationship far surpassing anything we can imagine now, including marriage. And so as you walk through life and in a fairly hostile culture as a single person, recognize that you will ultimately not find that perfect relationship on this earth. Now, we have great relationships here. We should fully enjoy life as much as we can. We should treasure and have precious life. I get that. But understand, there's always going to be a bit of an ache. In fact, look at verse 32. Love the way he handles this. I want you to be free from anxieties. Look at the end of verse 35. The beginning of verse 35. I say this for your own benefit. I want you, single person, listen. I want you to be free from anxiety. How's that sound? Come on, how's it sound? Who's on the anxiety-free platform? Who wants to run on that this year? Yeah, good, thanks. Steve is for it. Single or married, I'm for it too. And then he says, verse 30, it's for our benefit. Because so many people have the idea, well, God, really what he's doing is he's robbing my joy. Which brings me to the second thing, that if I'm going to be a single, well, what should I be? I should be at peace. I should not have a constant sense of churning. My joy, my happiness is out there, embodied in someone else or in some relationship I currently don't have. Be at peace. One day God will fulfill that, but it's not now. Second, be devoted. Be devoted. And he takes a lot of time to develop this. Verse 32, I want you to be free from anxieties. And here's what he means by that. The unmarried man is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to please him. The presumption there, isn't it interesting? The presumption there is that single people have an advantage. How often has the church communicated that? That in their walk with the Lord, an unmarried man or an unmarried woman has more time and more focus that they can give to the things of the Lord. Verse 33. The married man is anxious about worldly things, how to please his wife. By the way, that's absolutely the right thing to be worried about, to be anxious about. Marriage, man or woman, right? We understand this applies equally to husbands and wives. Marriage brings with it a set of commitments and responsibilities that will take my time and my money and my energy and my emotional investment. We get married, we have kids, we're going to soccer practice or baseball practice or whatever debate team and all. And that just puts demands on a family. And he's saying, if you're unmarried, if you're single, you have tremendous opportunity without those kinds of good and legitimate but real distractions in life. And a little further down, his interests are divided. Look at verse 34. The unmarried or betrothed woman. Now, betrothed is a word we don't use much. It means this: single, never married. In the context of the New Testament, betrothed would likely mean a father or an older man has sort of said, you're going to marry this one. It could have been an arranged marriage, or it could have been, okay, you guys have fallen in love, we're going to go ahead. Like Mary and Joseph, you're not yet married, but there's an understanding that one day you will be, and so you're kind of off the shelf, you're in a relationship. So when we see betrothed, you're here, think young, never married. We're going to see unmarried, they are either divorced or they're widows, because he's going to address both of those as well. And so what he's saying here at verse 28, if a young woman, a betrothed woman, marries, she's not sinned. I'm sorry, I jumped ahead. Let's go back to, I went too far back. Let's go to verse 34, yeah. The unmarried betrothed woman is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to be holy in body and spirit. The married woman is anxious about worldly things, how to please her husband, which again, that ought to be a concern. There ought to be that sort of mutual concern to please our spouse. Look at verse 35. Now you see the context. I say this for your own benefit. Look at the rest of that phrase. Not to lay any restraint upon you. Great, great little tidbit of information. The original word for restraint is a noose. God is saying, if you will follow my ways, you may think what I'm trying to do is just put a noose around you and stop you from having any more fun or any more joy or any more really rewarding relationships. Paul is saying, understand, I want to free you from anxiety. I want you to understand this is for your benefit and it is not going to constrain or restrain you. Here's what he's aiming for, the end of verse 35. I want to promote good order, so that our lives aren't a chaos of wreck and ruin and broken relationship. And I want to secure your undivided devotion to the Lord. Single person, what God is looking for from you is no different than what God is looking for from every believer. Be devoted to Him. Make the Lord Jesus Christ the ultimate pursuit in your life. Walk with Christ now. Your spiritual maturity does not have to wait until you put a ring on it. So, talked about idols a little while ago. Idols that singles may put on the shelf and to which they may bow down. Marriage. If only I had that person. If only I were married, then I would do A, B, C, D, E, F, G for God. And rather than the Lord being the idol, that is the thing we desire and the thing we work toward and pursue, marriage, or that person is. Others have the idol of pleasure. For the single pining for marriage, they can beat them. I hate myself that I'm single. When am I going to get married and get a life? And that becomes the idol. We look there to find our satisfaction. We look there to find when life begins. And others take the approach of pleasure. I love that I'm single. I'm going to pursue relationships that I like. And this can lead to a dissolute lifestyle, perhaps even to sexual immorality, is single life. Man, I get it. It's a sex-saturated world out there. And it can be very difficult then for singles. How do I deal with that? And so some say, if I just could get married. And some say, you know what? I'm going to enjoy the pleasures of marriage now, even though I'm single. And that can bring us, single, can bring you singles to a very hard place where you may have two idols on the shelf. One, really feeling badly about yourself because you're single. Secondly, feeling badly about yourself because you're also pursuing relationships that are wrong. Here's the lie of Satan with which we must deal. Remember the Garden of Eden? Genesis chapter 3, I'm not saying, Steve, you're old enough to remember the Garden of Eden. I mean, you remember the narrative and the scriptures about the Garden of Eden. And so, perfect location, perfect creation, God giving very clear commands. All of this is yours. You may eat from every tree, except... And Satan, in the form of a snake, slithered in there and said what? What was his very first line of attack? Did God really say? And then he dropped this sort of doubt bomb. And the day you eat, you'll be like gods. It's like, newsflash, they were already like God. They were created in his image. Here's the lie of Satan. God's keeping something from us. In fact, the lie of Satan is if you obey God, you will not be happy and you will miss out on something. There are a lot of single believers who have a very genuine faith in Jesus Christ who say, but if I live my life fully devoted to Jesus Christ, I'm not going to have any fun at all. Or I may never find the right person, so at least I'm in this relationship now. Maybe take a look at Psalm 81:10. Psalm 81:10, the context is very simple. It's rehearsing God's people, the history of God's people. And we're going to project it, so... And they get to this point in the rehearsal of the history of God's people where God's people turned away toward idols, thinking in pursuing the idols they will find their joy. Now listen to verse 10. The Lord speaks. I am the Lord your God who brought you up out of Egypt. See how it circles back to conversion? God saved me from something. He empowered me. He put me into his family by faith. And look at what he says. Listen to the invitation. Open your mouth wide and I will fill it. I redeemed you. I saved you. Would you not trust me to satisfy your deepest desires? So while the lie of Satan is that if I obey God, I'll miss out on something and not have happiness, here's the truth of God. When you come to me and obey me, I will bless you. Single, be devoted to Jesus Christ. Do it now. Don't wait until you're older or married or this or that or the next thing. Be devoted now here where we are. What does that look like, Scott? I mean, that's a big word, devoted. Fill it out. Well, I'll give you four things to think about I believe would be accurate in reflection to the Scriptures. Grow in character. Grow in character. Am I reflecting in my character and my development as a single person? Am I developing the character that reflects Jesus Christ? Am I honest, trustworthy? Am I good? kind, gentle, forgiving. You go through all the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5. Develop that now. Here's one of the truths about marriage that God uses. It's like a giant sledgehammer in some of our lives. He's constantly breaking up selfishness. Because marriage is about someone else. And single, you just don't have to deal with that. Develop character. Second, walk in purity. Walk in purity. If you're back in 1 Corinthians, look at chapter 6. Just one chapter over. It's still the same context of relationships. Look at verse 18. Flee from sexual immorality. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but the immoral person sins against his own body. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? See, I love how often the scriptures go to the issue of the why. Why, Scott, in this day and age of all kinds of freedom sexually, would I ever choose to walk a moral line that is incredibly difficult to follow? Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit whom you have from God? When we were developing the plans for this building, just a few, not many, but a few said, let me get this straight. This is a gym. You have basketball hoops hanging down in the auditorium. Where is the stained glass window? I don't see any stained glass window. There's no pews, there's chairs, and it's going to be like a basketball kind of floor. And it was a great opportunity for me and some of our elders to do some teaching about, understand in the New Testament, so the day of Pentecost, when the Spirit of God took up residence in the life of every believer, God doesn't dwell in buildings. We get that, right? A little weak, but I'm trusting you do get that. This is not a holy place, except when God's people are here, and then it's holy. Of course we take care of it. It's a tool that we want to use and be good stewards. But you get my point. It's not like we're closer to God here other than in the context of being under the authority of his word and together with his people. So the Spirit of God is magnified. Is there more of us here? When I am on a date with someone, the Spirit of God is accompanying me. How does that inform my moral choices? In fact, let me say this. I would encourage you to set your convictions early. Getting down the road in a relationship and discovering this is not a good person for you is an incredibly painful thing. And honestly, I have had to deal with folks that have said, I kind of knew this wasn't good, but I was just afraid I wouldn't find anybody else. The short-term gain of compromising convictions for the sake of being in a relationship will be so outweighed by the long-term pain of being in a relationship that is destructive. That part of my devotion to Jesus Christ is even in my dating life, even as I begin to pursue relationship singles, I'm going to give Jesus sort of a vote in what I say and what I do and whom I'm dating. Set your convictions early. Walk in purity. Let me say a word about that. Look at chapter 7, verses 8 and 9. 1 Corinthians 7, 8 and 9. To the unmarried and to the widows, I say. So listen, he's addressing those who are unmarried. Maybe you're single, never married. Maybe you're divorced. We'll talk about that. I can't develop a full theology of divorce, but this chapter handles it pretty well. Or maybe you're a widow. To the unmarried and the widows, I say, it is good for them to remain single as I am. If you can do it, just stay single. That's fine. But if they cannot exercise self-control, and the idea is morally, sexually, they should marry. It's better to marry than to burn with passion. I mean, God bless the scriptures. They're so practical. Just get married. Now, within the constraints of the right person, a follower of Jesus Christ, someone who's sharing your faith and on the right trajectory. But the point is, if you're in this kind of relationship and you're wrestling with that and losing some battles, maybe it's time to go to justice of the peace. If you're young, talk to mom and dad first. Grow in character, walk in purity. Third, walk with others. develop rich, meaningful relationships. You should be in a small group. This is why we normally don't have segregated small groups. In other words, if you're single, you got to go to this small group because we just want singles together, right? We think a healthier way to approach the body of Christ is there are something singles will learn in a group with married folks, and there's something that marrieds will learn in a group with single folks. And so it's not one is better than the other. Together, walk through life as a community of believers, and so walk with others. Fourth, serve the Lord. Serve the Lord. What are we doing with our time, singles? How are we using the extra resources that we have? It's about 20 years ago that I heard John Stott preach over at Christ Church of Oak Brook. John Stott at that point was about 70-something years old. He'd been the rector and the lead pastor at All Souls Church in London, England for a long time at that point. He lived another 20 years until he was over 90 years of age. He was interviewed in 2011 about the fact that he had been a lifelong single, never married, and was an extremely effective pastor and writer. One of the great Christian thinkers, along with like C.S. Lewis of the 20th century, middle of the 20th century. Here's what he said in response to an interview about, you're 90 years old, you've been single all your life. In spite of the rumors to the contrary, I have never taken a solemn vow or heroic decision to remain single. On the contrary, during my 20s and 30s, like most people, I was expecting to marry one day. In fact, during this period, I twice began to develop a relationship with a lady who I thought was God's choice for my lifelong partner. But when the time came to make a decision, I can best explain it by saying that I lacked an assurance from God that He meant for me to marry this one. So I drew back. That's a hard decision. And when that had happened twice, I naturally began to believe that God meant for me to remain single. Now, listen to his closing sentence. A 90-year-old man looking in retrospect at an extremely fruitful life of service to the Lord and to thousands, maybe millions of others who benefited from his writings and his ministry. Looking back with the benefit of hindsight, I think I know why. I could never have traveled or written as extensively as I have if I had had the responsibility of wife and family. So while it's going to be the vast minority of people, maybe very few that even are listening to my voice right now, some of you perhaps have this gift of singleness and a calling to say, you know what, probably you're not going to have a partner in life. You're not going to get married. And I would wrestle through that if I were you, but I would also say that I will dedicate my life to serving Jesus Christ. Places no husband and wife could ever go for the cause of the gospel, you could probably go, and you could go safely and be effective. Consider that. Look beyond the cultural standard of saying, well, you got to get married. And understand that you can serve the Lord. Serve here in our church with small groups, with children, many different ways. Our singles already own huge amounts of ministry, and we should honor them for that. How can I live in a way that honors the Lord in singleness? I can be at peace. I can be devoted. Here's the third thing. I can be hopeful. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 7, the last several verses, verses 36 to the end of the chapter. Be hopeful. If anyone thinks that he is not behaving properly toward his betrothed, now here we're talking about the young unmarried woman, she's engaged or in some way thinking about marriage. And this is the person to whom she's engaged. This is a young singles in a relationship. Let's summarize it that way. If his passions are strong and it has to be, let him do as he wishes. Let them marry. It's no sin. Remember, the Bible has a very balanced view of singleness and marriage. They're both ways to honor the Lord. But whoever is firmly established in his heart, being under no necessity and having the desire under control, he has determined to keep his heart in his heart to keep her as his betrothed. He'll do well. I'm not going to get married. That's okay. It's okay. In fact, verse 38 tells us where Paul came down on this issue. He who marries his betrothed does well. You're in a relationship, you get married, that's a great thing. God bless you. Go on. But he said, he who refrains from marriage does even better. Paul was single, apparently thought, you know, that was a good way to be. And verse 39 and 40, the last two verses, he deals with widows. So let's say a word about that since you're also single. A wife is bound to her husband as long as he lives. if her husband dies, she's free to be married to whom she wishes, only in the Lord. In other words, you're a widow or a widower, you want to get married, God bless you, get married, just find a believer. Which means in the Lord, in the context of someone who also has a personal faith in Christ. And verse 40, once again, he says, yet in my judgment, she is happier, that is, the widow is happier, if she remains as she is, and I think that I too have the Spirit of God. Let's talk about hopefulness. We've talked about being at peace, so that for the single person, my ultimate joy is not out there somewhere in someone else or in a relationship that I don't have right now. I can be as joyful and fulfilled in a relationship with God right now as a single as any married person can be. We talked about being devoted, so that my first priority as a single person is to pursue a relationship with Jesus Christ, resulting in the growth of my character, things like that. I said it at 9 o'clock. Don't work so hard on character. Work hard on a relationship with Jesus Christ. He said, if you abide in me, you'll bear much fruit. The natural outgrowth of abiding in Christ is fruit. Okay? And so be devoted in that way. Let's talk about being hopeful. When I say the gift of singleness, some people get really confused about that. The reason they do that is because, well, it's a confusing concept. Are you saying to me, Scott, that there are some people, and maybe I'm one of them, who's going to be single, I'm just totally good with that, and there's no problems, and I don't have to worry about it, I don't think about getting married at all? No, that's not what I'm saying. Let me use an analogy that might help. I have the gift of teaching, I hope. I mean, it's an area I love, but I have to work really hard to make any sense at all on Sunday mornings. And I have to start in the week, and I have to put thoughts together. And it's never on Sunday what it was on Friday. You know, the whole Friday is the rewrite day, and Sunday morning early before the 9 o'clock is rewrite day. I've got the gift. I love to do that. I'm very content with what I'm doing. But I've got to work hard at it. Perhaps you have a gift of singleness, but you're going to have to work hard at being content with that, at pursuing Christ. It's not as though you are some sort of a stone with no passions or no desires. It is underneath those passions and desires, there's a settled confidence and a conviction, I'm okay as a single person. And then just as I close, let me deal with the issue of the sexuality. We've dealt with it, just touched on it briefly a while back. I recognize as a single, well, I'm married, so I don't recognize as much in my gut as I did probably when I was single. I understand we live in a very sex-saturated society, and that it would be a very difficult thing to live in a way to please God, and that there are likely those who have crossed those kinds of boundaries. Let me give you a word of encouragement from Psalm 130. I just want to make sure we close on an issue of hope. Psalm 130, verses 3 and 4, say this. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? Lord, if you're just keeping a running total, nobody has a prayer. But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I have hope. As we close our time of message, let me encourage you, single person, set your affections on the Lord. Deal with unconfessed sin in your life. And embrace and enjoy the freedom that that brings. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. Again, it's so practical. It deals so directly with those issues we face. Lord, I pray for our single folks here that they would indeed be at peace. God, there would be a lack of churning. There would be a contentment. There would be a deep abiding trust that you will bring the right person along at the right time for your good, for your glory. Father, I pray for singles who have walked astray and gone a long way from the faith or turned aside from the path, the devotion. God, that they would experience the freedom of forgiveness and a restoration of right relationship with you and with others. God, I pray for married people that we might honor, respect, have a deep affection for those who are singles, that they would contribute to our church in so many rich and good ways. Father, for our singles, God, sustain them with your grace. Help them to live in a way that's pleasing and honorable before you, I pray. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.